Friends, welcome. Welcome one and all to this joyous afternoon of worship together. We gather in the name of the Father, the Son, and the Holy Spirit, and we come to affirm and to witness to that which God has ordained, that there are many gifts, but there is one Spirit, that teaching elders in our Presbyterian tradition shall in all things be committed to teaching the faith, and equipping the saints for the work of ministry in a world in need. So on this joyous afternoon, we participate in what we see as the work of the Holy Spirit, that in God's grace and God's timing, the blessing of Reverend Ann Conklin's presence as servant and leader and shepherd and guide to this beloved congregation of First Presbyterian Church shall be solemnized and celebrated. So we gather and we invite you to worship in spirit and in truth with your hearts, giving praise to God the Father Almighty. Welcome. Welcome to this time of worship together. Let's call one another to worship. God, you call us from our sometimes separate and isolated lives to serve as a people. You call us from isolation to community, from separation to communion, to be your people, to be the church. You call us from the shadow of the past into your own bright future, from shadow to light, from despair to hope. Your call beckons us into life and trust. You call us to lean into your strength, to trust your amazing, life-giving spirit. In gladness, let us praise and worship the triune God. Let us join together in our prayer of adoration, praying, O God, source of all beauty and goodness, your grace comes fresh every morning. In each new day, you give us light. We praise you for never-failing love that satisfies our needs and shows us the way to follow. We rejoice in your constant care, for you are faithful in love for all people, offering your salvation through Jesus Christ, in whose name we pray. Amen. I'd invite us all to stand and sing hymn number 150, Come Christians, Join to Sing.
You may be seated. The proof of God's amazing love is this. While we were yet sinners, Christ died for us. Because we are united in faith with Christ, we dare to approach God in confidence. In faith and penitence, let us now confess our sins before God and in the company of one another, reading together. Almighty God, by water and your Holy Spirit, You baptized us to be your own and called the church into being. We confess that we often hold back the love of your Spirit among us. We do not listen to your word of grace, speak the good news of your love boldly, or live as a people made one in Christ. Have mercy on us, O God. Forgive our sin and transform our lives by the power of your Holy Spirit to make strong our bodies. Lord, our Savior, Jesus Christ. Amen. Since God has forgiven us in Christ, let us forgive one another and live in God's love. Friends, believe the gospel. In Jesus Christ, we are forgiven and made new. Thanks be to God. Alleluia. Amen.
Please be seated. Let us pray together. Send us your Holy Spirit, O God, that these words might speak to us as your words, so that our lives would bear witness to the good news of Jesus Christ our Lord. Amen. Friends, listen now to what the Spirit is saying to the church as we hear these words from 1 Corinthians chapters 3 and 4. For when one says, I belong to Paul, and another, I belong to Apollos, are you not merely human? What then is Apollos and what is Paul? Servants through whom you came to believe as the Lord assigned to each. I planted, Apollos watered, but God gave the growth. And so neither the one who plants nor the one who waters is anything, but only God who gives the growth. The one who plants and the one who waters have a common purpose, and each will receive wages according to the labors of each. For we are God's servants, working together. You are God's field, God's building. And so let no one boast about human leaders, for all things are yours, whether Paul or Apollos or Cephas or the world or life or death or the present or the future, all belong to you. And you belong to Christ. And Christ belongs to God. Now think of us in this way as servants of God and stewards of God's mysteries. And moreover, it is required of servants that they be found trustworthy. But for me, it is a very small thing that I should be judged by you or by any human court. I do not even judge myself. I am not aware of anything against myself, but I am not thereby acquitted. It is the Lord who judges me, and therefore do not pronounce judgment before the time, before the Lord comes, who will bring to light all things now hidden in darkness and will disclose the purposes of the heart. This is the word of the Lord. I have to tell you, it is great for me to be back in Santa Barbara, smelling the eucalyptus, walking the beach, trying to view the Channel Islands through the fog. Now, as some of you know, Westmont is my alma mater. My wife Pam, a Pomona grad, tells me that I didn't go to college, I went to camp. And sometimes it was really hard for this Seattle boy used to the rain to study with the sun and the beach constantly calling. And so what a joy it is for me to be invited back for this special occasion by my dear friend and longtime colleague, Ann Conklin. And while First Presbyterian Church has a marvelous history which will appropriately influence your future, an installation is a celebration of a new beginning. Now, you were in transition for 4 years as you worked through a number of issues in a time that was also complicated by COVID. But thanks to the competence of a great staff, exemplary interim leadership, and the diligence of a hardworking search committee, it looks like God has indeed answered your prayers for new pastoral leadership in the person of the Reverend Ann Conklin. And so I want to reflect with you on how your new beginning can be as productive as it can be, as it lays a foundation for what we pray will be a long and a positive relationship. And I think a good place to start is with this passage from 1 Corinthians, because Paul here is writing to a divided church, a church that is hungry for positive leadership. Now, let's not press the comparison too far, because I don't see First Presbyterian Church as a divided church, but we know that it is human nature to have favorites, whether it's a favorite teacher or a favorite minister or a favorite friend. But when that happens in the church, we often find competing factions developing. And in the case of the church at Corinth, this seemed to be a real danger, a danger that would not only divide the church, but would also undermine its influence. Now, early in chapter 3, Paul is trying to help them understand that it's not about power or control, but rather, it's about the gifts. It's about the gifts that God gives to do the job. As Paul writes, I planted, Apollos watered, but it was God who gave the growth. Now, apparently, the problem was that as the people gave allegiance to a particular leader, competition occurred that resulted in division. Now, here, Paul is attacking the problem in a rather personal way. Now, he knows that some have chosen sides and are no doubt arguing for their leadership preference. You can almost hear them arguing. I like Apollos because his sermons are better. I like Cephas because he's more approachable. I like Paul because he's more persuasive and decisive. But here, Paul is trying to level the playing field by saying, no, 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 you've got it all wrong. We are not in competition. It is about all of us using the gifts that we have been given to build up the whole church. Your thinking is all wrong, says Paul. It's not about being an authoritarian leader who commands blind obedience. You need to think of us as servants and as stewards. Now, frankly, that was a definition of leadership that was relatively unknown in a world of kings and monarchs. It was a top-down world where the idea of an egalitarian church was revolutionary. Not much in their experience had prepared them for a church where there is neither Jew nor Greek, male nor female, slave nor free. And actually, it can be argued that things haven't changed much. While such equality is still our ideal, we also live in a hierarchical world that too often defaults into top-down leadership. Now, a number of years ago, Robert Greenleaf wrote a book that has become a classic entitled Servant Leadership, which tried to explore what a different kind of approach would look like. Now, servant leadership has a nice ring to it, but how do you know? How do you know when you're trying to be a servant leader? And in his book, Greenleaf lays out four principles of servant leadership. First, a servant leader encourages a diversity of thought. Now, while that may seem obvious to a church like First Presbyterian, which operates in a very different way, most institutions have a gravitational pull toward sameness and agreement. I have to admit that I prefer having people agree with me rather than having them argue with me. But the truth is, that is a demon that all of us are constantly trying to exercise, because growth never happens when we are surrounded with sycophants. Now, one experience comes to mind. A person who had been nominated to serve on our session asked to see me, and she was a highly respected person in the congregation, and it was not a surprise to me that she had been nominated. But I was surprised when she told me that because she disagreed with me on one of the major issues that was facing our congregation at the time, she assumed that I would rather not have her serving on the session. Unfortunately, I have found that assumption is not uncommon. And I finally convinced her to serve, and she did. I don't think she ever changed her mind about that particular issue in question, but we became dear friends. Now, the second principle of servant leadership, as offered by Greenleaf, was that a servant leader creates a culture of trust. And friends, that's not as easy as it sounds, because it takes time. It brings to mind the advice of a mentor who, when I asked, what does it take to be a successful minister, he said simply to me, "Riley, you've just got to love the people. And then after about 3 years, they'll start loving you back." And what happens in that interval, hopefully for you, less than 3 years, is that a leader creates a culture of trust. Now, the third principle of servant leadership is that a servant leader has an unselfish mindset. I think of Harry Truman's famous dictum, "The buck stops here." We have too many leaders whose first instinct is to blame someone else, but a true leader is one who creates a culture where success has many names. As someone has said, when you don't care who gets the credit, it's amazing what can happen. And finally, according to Robert Greenleaf, a servant leader fosters leadership in others. I believe that one of the great joys of parenting is to watch your children grow, watching them grow into adulthood and to exceed whatever benchmarks we as parents may have set as they exhibit kindness and intelligence and competence in making a positive impact on the world. And as it relates to the church, I've always asked my congregations to think of me as a human being in residence, helping them to discover their gifts and to use them to promote the reign of God. And I would often say with conviction that I believed that there was someone in the church that could do every part of my job better than I could do it. But my job was to help those people exercise their gifts for the glory of God. And if I did that, I would always have a job. Now, so being a servant is the first part of the job description of a leader, as outlined by Paul. But the second part, according to Paul, is to be a steward of the mysteries of God. Now, steward is not a word that we use very much these days, unless you're traveling on a cruise ship or betting the horses. But one of the translations that I consulted used manager instead of steward, but somehow manager of the mysteries of God doesn't quite do it for me. That makes me think of a paper shuffler organizing a filing cabinet. Now, a stronger understanding would be to think caretaker or guardian. In this sense, we are constantly guarding against the temptation of domesticating the mysteries of God when we handle the holy. A quick illustration. In many traditions, including our Presbyterian tradition, only ordained clergy are allowed to officiate at the communion table. And since these same traditions believe in the priesthood of all believers, this can seem like we're creating an unnecessary hierarchy. Now, some years ago, I was part of a wedding where the couple asked a friend who wasn't an ordained minister to give them communion as part of their wedding service. And when we got to the communion part of the service, the uninitiated officiant went to the table and took the bread and the cup and said, "Well, you know, it's been a long day for the bride and groom. They got up really early, and they just had a bite to eat for breakfast and hardly anything for lunch. But what do we have here? Got a little bread, and we've got some juice." Friends, let me just say that that is not how you introduce the mystery of the communion table. You see, to be a steward of the mysteries of God is to handle the holy with reverence and respect. These are the wonders of God's work that we don't fully understand. Think of words like grace and unconditional love. To be a steward of such mysteries means to faithfully proclaim the gospel in our particular contexts, to build each other up in the faith, and to keep alive a witness to the love and the justice of a faithful God. Now, a final theme, as Paul is trying to flesh out the kind of leadership necessary in the church, is judgment. Now, Paul isn't worried about God's judgment here. Actually, he welcomes it. But no, as he is addressing a divided church, he is concerned about how judgmental they can be, both about each other and about their leaders. Now, let it be said that judgmentalism cannot be avoided in the church or any organization. In the church, we all have our opinions, but the key is how we share them. In love, or with an overlay of disapproval. Now, if Paul was on your personnel committee, he would tell Anne, as your new pastor, don't let the critics get you down. And don't even be too hard on yourself, because the ultimate judge of a job well done is God and time. Now, we know that in the short term, accountability is important. Now, most organizations have an evaluation process, but as one friend of mine says, the best evaluation process is about glows and grows. That is, what is being done well, and how can we improve? Now, Paul says it's a small thing to be judged by you, but the truth is that most of us here are critics out of proportion to our supporters. Unfortunately, we can pay so much attention to the negative that it immobilizes. But hopefully, we can make room for self-reflection and accountability, because none of us is perfect and all of us need growth. Now, to that end, The ministry to which Paul is calling the church at Corinth is one of mutual ministry. Now, certainly, leaders are called to have special gifts for ministry in the church, but that ministry is always seen as mutual. In fact, as you install Anne as your new pastor, you as a congregation will be asked four questions. Will you accept Anne as chosen by God through the voice of this congregation to guide you in the way of Jesus Christ? Will you agree to pray for her, encourage her, and to respect her decisions and to follow as she guides, serving Jesus Christ, who alone is the head of the church? Will you promise to pay her fairly and provide for her welfare as she works among you, and to stand by her in trouble and to share her joys? Will you listen to the words she preaches, welcome her pastoral care, and honor her authority as she seeks to honor and obey Jesus Christ our Lord? Well, there, I've given you a preview of the test, with the only acceptable answer being yes. And when you say yes to those questions, you will be sealing a covenant. You will be sealing a covenant that will enable you to move forward in a shared ministry which will use all of the gifts of this great church to more fully establish God's reign of love and justice in Santa Barbara and beyond. Now, new beginnings are always uncertain. But when you have laid the proper groundwork, and you have, and when you trust each other, and you do, and when you believe that God is in it, and God is, then you can be confident that you are entering an exciting and productive future in the life of the First Presbyterian Church of Santa Barbara. And may God bless you as you begin this wonderful journey together. Amen.
Thank you. Please join me in this litany of gifts. As in one body, we have many parts, and each part has its own function. So all of us together with Christ are one body, and we all belong to each other. We have different gifts according to the grace God has given us. If your gift is to hear God's word, speak it out in faith. If your gift is service, live to serve others. If your gift is the heart of a teacher, teach what is true. Let preachers preach with conviction, and givers give freely. Let leaders work diligently for the people, and let those who serve the poor do so faithfully and with compassion. Let us not lack for enthusiasm, but be ardent in spirit, serving the Lord, rejoicing in hope, patient in suffering, constant in prayer, supporting one another, and welcoming all in Christ's name. By God's grace and for God's purposes, may we do so. Amen.
We are called out by God to be the Church of Jesus Christ, a sign in the world today of the new life that God intends for all. In our life together, we are to display the new reality that sin is forgiven, reconciliation accomplished, and the dividing walls of hostility torn down. As the living body of Christ, the Church is called to proclaim the good news of salvation, to present the claims of the gospel on people's lives, and to demonstrate Christ's love in service to the world. We are called to undertake this mission even at the risk of life, trusting God in all things. In faith, we embrace a new openness to what God is doing in our time, a renewed obedience to our Lord Jesus Christ, and a new joy in our common worship and work. Today, we reclaim our historic calling and remember the great ends of the Church. The proclamation of the gospel for the salvation of humankind, the shelter, nurture, and spiritual fellowship of the children of God, the maintenance of divine worship, the preservation of the truth, the promotion of social righteousness, the exhibition of the kingdom of God to the world. The ministry of the Church is shared by pastor and people so that all together may fulfill the mission to which we are called in Jesus Christ. The particular responsibility of the ministry of the word and sacrament is to build up the Church and serve the people of God, so that the word may be rightly proclaimed and the sacraments rightly celebrated. The call to this ministry has been extended by the congregation, accepted by the candidate, and approved by the presbytery. Therefore, the Presbytery of Santa Barbara will now install Reverend Ann Conklin as the pastor of First Presbyterian Church.
Ann, would you please come forward? Excuse me. Ann, in baptism, you are claimed by the love of God, clothed in the grace of Jesus Christ, and anointed with the gifts of the Holy Spirit to share Christ's mission in the world. Now you have been called by God through the voice of the Church for new service and ministry in Jesus' name. In accordance with the Constitution of the Presbyterian Church USA, please show your commitment by responding to these questions. Anne, Do you trust in the Lord Jesus Christ, your Savior, acknowledging him Lord of all, head of the church, and through him believe in one God, Father, Son, and Holy Spirit?
I do.
And do you accept the scriptures of the Old and New Testament to be by the Holy Spirit the unique and authoritative witness to Jesus Christ in the Church Universal and God's word to you?
I do.
And do you sincerely receive and adopt the tenets of the Reformed faith as expressed in the confessions of our church as authentic and reliable expositions of what Scripture leads us to believe and do? And will you be instructed by those confessions as you lead the people of God?
I will.
Will you be a minister of the word and sacrament in obedience to Jesus Christ under the authority of scriptures and continually guided by our confessions?
I will.
Will you be governed by our church's polity, and will you abide by the discipline? Will you be a friend among your colleagues in ministry, working with them, subject to the ordering of God's word and spirit?
I will.
And will you, in your own life, seek to follow Lord Jesus Christ, love your neighbors, and work for the reconciliation of the world?
I will, with God's help.
And do you promise to further the peace, unity, and purity of the church?
I do.
And will you pray for and seek to serve the people with energy, intelligence, imagination, and love?
I will.
And will you be a faithful minister, proclaiming the good news in word and sacrament, teaching faith, and caring for people? Will you be active in government and discipline, serving in the governing bodies of the church? And in your ministry, will you try to show the love of justice and of Jesus Christ?
I will.
And now for the congregation, this is the test. Do we, the congregation of the church, accept Anne, chosen by God through the voice of this congregation, to guide us in the way of Jesus Christ?
We do.
Do we agree to pray for her, to encourage her, to respect her decisions, and to follow as she guides us, serving Jesus Christ, who alone is the head of the church?
We do.
Do we promise to pay her fairly and provide for her welfare as she works among us, and to stand by her in trouble and share her joys?
We do.
And will we listen to the word she preaches, welcome her pastoral care, and honor her authority as she seeks to honor and obey Jesus Christ, our Lord?
We
will. And now we'll invite the elders and teaching elders to come forward for the laying on of hands. And I've been asked to have you bring with you your worship folder for a responsive prayer.
Lord God of our salvation, by your word, you called creation into being and made us in your image to love and serve you. By your saving love, you sent Jesus Christ to live among us, to redeem your people and establish your peace. By your Holy Spirit, you shower gifts on your children, opening hearts and worlds to your grace, empowering us to live holy and joyful lives. We praise you, eternal God, for the church throughout the world, born of your love, saved by your grace, and sustained by your Holy Spirit. Make us the community you have called us to be, your very own people, gifted to proclaim your marvelous love. Reading together. Gracious God, we praise you that you have chosen servants in every age to speak your word and lead your loyal people. We give you thanks for your servant Anne and for the ministry to which you have called her. Give Anne a full measure of the gifts of your Holy Spirit, both in her walk of faith and for her work of ministry. Anoint Anne with power to proclaim the gospel in word and sacrament, in witness and in service, in truth and in love, for the building up of the people of God, and for the glory of the Lord Jesus Christ.
Gracious God, pour out your Holy Spirit upon this congregation and all its people, that baptized into your service and united in Christ's love, they may serve you with joy and faithfulness until all things are made new. Let the word they proclaim be your word of truth. Let the compassion they show to the world be your love in Christ. And let their common life as pastor and people together be holy, peaceable, and glad in your spirit. Gracious God, accept all that we are and have in the service of Jesus Christ, and strengthen us by the power of your Holy Spirit, now and forever. Amen. Amen.
Thank you, thank you, thank you. Yeah. Lee, do you want to?
Anne, as a minister of the word and sacrament in the Church of Jesus Christ, you are now installed as pastor of this congregation. Be faithful and true in your ministry so that your whole life will bear witness to the crucified and risen Christ.
Alleluia. Thank you. Praise the Lord.
Thank you. Our ushers are now going to take a collection, and I think it's important for you to know that it's services of installation. The collection is used by the Committee for Preparation for Ministry to support candidates under the care of the Presbytery. Thank you.
Greetings to you in the name of our Lord Jesus Christ. My name is Todd Billings, and it's such a joy for me to be able to offer a charge in this installation service for Pastor Ann Conklin. I'd like to start with a personal word to Ann, continue with a very short scripture passage and a thought with that, and I'll end with a short formal charge. So, Anne, it is hard to believe it was almost 17 years ago when you were in my very first systematic theology class that I taught at Western Theological Seminary. I was just finishing up at Harvard. I was a very green professor, and I still remember your questions and your eagerness and wanting to meet after class to learn more sources to learn about. And there was a passion there, not just for head knowledge, but for theology as the exploration and entering into communion with the triune God. I continued to see that as you continued on as a student, your deep curiosity and love for scripture and for the best of the Christian tradition. It was in 2010 I was able to be in your ordination service. And it was a few years later where, as you continued to grow as a pastor in pastoral ministry, continued to seek further biblical and theological understanding, I began to see how you were teaching me and how you had been a pastor to me, especially because 2 years after your ordination, I was diagnosed with cancer and started to undergo that treatment. I started to see how God has woven various parts of your background together for a pastoral presence that is powerful. I was blessed by your preaching because it was from a live stream of ongoing learning and love for God's word. But I was also blessed and moved and encouraged by your presence as someone who has worked in physical therapy with bodies and prayed for people in physical pain. Your prayers for me and our many conversations amidst my own cancer treatment has been a powerful witness to me. And as we've continued to work together, as you were part of 4 colloquies with the Louisville Institute for Pastor Theologians, I've continued to cherish your insights that you have brought and also our friendship. So thank you. For a brief scripture passage, it's a bit unusual for a charge, but I've felt led to draw upon one of the parables of the kingdom, a short one from Matthew 13. Jesus put before them another parable. The kingdom of heaven is like a mustard seed that someone took and sowed in his field. It is the smallest of all seeds, but when it has grown, it is the greatest of shrubs and becomes a tree, so that the birds of the air can come and make nests in its branches. As I think of this passage and the shrub and then the tree that the tiny, tiny little mustard seed grows into, I also think of the tree, the flourishing tree in Psalm 1 by streams of water, and the image that provides for our life in God. And I find it to be a deeply countercultural image for the kingdom and for ministry today. there are so many pressures in our cultural moment for the church, for an individual congregation, for a minister to be defined by what we are against or who we are against rather than what we are for. There are so many pressures to make things efficient and effective and visibly impressive. And yet, the ministry of the gospel is much more like agriculture. It's in for the long haul. As the parable of the sower, which comes shortly before this in the Gospel of Matthew, you throw out the seeds of the kingdom with lavishness, and God provides the growth. In day-to-day and week-to-week life, it is not very impressive. I mean, you have this tiny, tiny little mustard seed. But as this grows and is cultivated over time, it provides a witness to the world. It becomes a tree that creatures can make nests in. This tree with branches out can provide shade for the brokenhearted and those who are in moments of deep weakness. A tree with its branches out takes in the impurities from the air and lets out purities. It's a blessing to the world. And in this sense, also bears witness to Jesus Christ as we abide in Christ, as the branches connected to him. Now in a congregation's life and in pastoral ministry, there will be times when the winds are intense, when the storms come. But if the tree has a deep root system, rooted in finding nourishment in God's word in Christ, then it will stand. It will make it through. And so my encouragement is to follow the call of God to this slow and, from a worldly perspective, unimpressive path of growth in Christ, growth into the fullness of Christ for the sake and the witness to the world. And love Christ, feed his lambs, tend his sheep. Be an example in speech, in conduct, in love, in faith, in purity. Attend to reading, prayer, study, preaching, and teaching. Do not neglect the gift that is in you. Put these things into practice. Devote yourselves to them so that all may see your progress. Pay close attention to yourself and to your teaching. Continue in these things, for in doing this, as Paul says, you will save both yourself and your hearers. Guard what has been entrusted to you, and when the chief shepherd appears, you will win the crown of glory that never fades away. Amen.
Sisters and brothers in Christ, the Holy Spirit has led you to call Reverend Ann Conklin to be your pastor. Therefore, I charge you to be the church and welcome Ann to be your pastor. Your welcome of her ministry is not limited to today's joyful celebration. It must be affirmed again and again as you receive her preaching, teaching, pastoral care, administrative leadership, presbytery work, and community work. Trust that God knows what God is doing in calling your pastor, and so affirm her ministry among you. Become the church that the Holy Spirit is guiding and goading you to be. Pray often for your pastor, Anne, and for her family. You know that ministry can often be a lonely calling and one that is a target for criticism. Pray for Anne and offer a kind and encouraging word to her regularly. Send emails to say thank you to her for her faithfulness. Ephesians chapter 4 defines a pastor as one who equips the saints for the work of ministry, for building up the body of Christ. So, saints, be willing to be equipped. Be willing to undergo some construction work, some building, to your hearts and minds, based on her proclamation of God's word. She is called not only to interpret scripture, but she is called to interpret you and this city and this nation and our world. The Presbyterian liturgy of installation includes a biblical charge to the congregation, and as always, the Bible's words are far better than mine. So hear this additional charge from the book of 1 Peter. Above all, maintain constant love for one another, for love covers a multitude of sins. Be hospitable to one another without complaining. Like good stewards of the manifold grace of God, serve one another with whatever gift each of you has received. Whoever speaks must do so as one speaking the very words of God. Whoever serves must do so with the strength that God supplies, so that God may be glorified in all things through Jesus Christ. To him belong the glory and the power forever and ever. Amen.
Thank you. Friends, what a joyful day, and I am deeply moved and deeply grateful, and I thank you all for being here. And so as we are sent out to bear witness to the Word of God, may the many blessings of God, whose love is ever seeking us, and may the many blessings of Christ, whose grace is ever mending us, and may the many blessings of the Spirit, whose presence is ever opening us to new wonder and possibility, be with us all, both this day and for all our days to come. Amen. And would you join me now in singing a benediction response? This is one that we sang in seminary that is deeply meaningful to me. So let us sing together. That is my prayer, that together we would grow in grace and grow in God's love. And so I invite you to a reception now out on our patio so we can celebrate this covenant relationship together. Let us go in peace to love and serve the Lord. Amen.